Last year, I said the Lenovo Legion 5 was the best Ryzen gaming laptop available for the money, so let's find out if that's still the case, and if this year's new refreshed model is worth considering. I bought the Ryzen 7 5800H plus Nvidia RTX 3060 configuration for testing, as I thought that would be of most interest. Mine came with 16 gigs of memory, a 512 gig SSD, and a 15.6 inch 1080p 165Hz screen. Now there is also an all AMD version of the Legion 5 with the new RX 6600M graphics, but I'm still trying to get it. And there are also other Nvidia options with both lower and higher GPUs. You can check out other configurations as well as updated prices with those links down in the description. The Legion 5 has an all-plastic build, but I thought it felt nice enough. The finish is called Phantom Blue, a darker blue basically, but there's also a Stingray White finish. The laptop alone weighs about 2.5 kilos or 5.5 pounds, then 3.5 kilos or 7.8 pounds total with the large 300 watt power brick and cables. So on the heavier side for a 15 inch laptop. It's not thin or anything, but not huge either, just a regular 15-inch gaming laptop size. The 15.6-inch 1080p 165Hz screen has decent color gamut for a gaming laptop. Above average contrast, but the FreeSync range starts relatively high. The screen gets above 300 nits at maximum brightness, but it gets dim quite quickly without a whole lot of control at lower levels. The Lenovo Vantage software, the control panel for the laptop, lets you enable or disable Optimus, aka hybrid mode. With Optimus enabled, the screen still has FreeSync, and with Optimus disabled, you've instead got the option of G-Sync, so best of both worlds however you run it. The Vantage software also gives us the option to enable or disable panel overdrive, which should affect screen response time. I didn't actually find a difference between overdrive on or off though, so not sure if this was a bug, but we're looking at just under a 7 millisecond average greater gray response time. It's not amazing compared to others, even the 144Hz panel in last year's Legion 5 was more than 2 milliseconds faster, so hopefully the overdrive mode gets improved in a future software update. The Lenovo site claims a 3 millisecond response time with overdrive. This is the total amount of time it takes from a mouse button press to when a gunshot fires in CSGO. The total system latency was on the slower side, with more inconsistent results as per the higher standard deviation. Backlight bleed was very minor, I never noticed it during normal use, but this will vary between laptop and panel. There's a 720p camera above the screen in the middle. No IR for Windows Hello though, but there's a switch on the right that physically disconnects the camera for privacy. This is what the camera and microphone look and sound like, and this is what it sounds like while I'm typing on the keyboard. And you can actually see that the screen is wobbling a bit while I'm typing.
The Legion 5 is available with either a white backlit keyboard or 4-zone RGB, which is what mine has. You can use the function plus space shortcut to cycle through a few different effects or turn it off. However, there doesn't appear to be a keyboard shortcut for adjusting brightness. This is instead controlled through the Vantage software with two levels of brightness, and the speed of the effect can be adjusted between four different speed levels. You can modify the three profiles how you like, then use function and space to cycle between your changes. All keys and secondary functions get lit up. It's got 1.5 millimeters of key travel, and I'm glad that the arrow keys aren't small like others. As with other Lenovo laptops, personally, I liked typing on the keyboard. The precision touchpad is Mylar, so plastic. It feels nice and smooth, clicks anywhere, and works fine. It never got in the way while typing or playing games. The left has an air exhaust vent, a USB 3.2 Gen 2 Type-C port, and a 3.5mm audio combo jack. The right has the camera disconnect switch, a USB 3.2 Gen 1 Type-A port, and there's an air exhaust on this side too. The rest of the I/O is on the back between two corner air exhausts. From left to right, we've got a gigabit Ethernet port, second USB 3.2 Gen 2 Type-C port, three more USB 3.2 Gen 1 Type-A ports for 4 in total, HDMI 2.1 output, and the power input on the right.
The Type-C port on the back of the laptop can be used to charge it, but the one on the front left cannot. Both Type-C ports offer DisplayPort 1.4 support, so you can attach an external screen to either of them, and both connect directly to the Nvidia graphics.
There are some icons above the rear ports to help you see where you need to plug in without turning the laptop around, but they can be hard to see in a darker room as they don't light up like the Legion 7. There's nothing on the front, however the middle sticks out a little, making it very easy to grip onto when opening the lid, and the lid goes the full 180 degrees back for sharing. You can also optionally enable flip to boot, which automatically powers the laptop on when you open the lid, something I prefer given chances are I want to use the machine when I do this. Some of you were asking about hinge issues. I'm not aware of any with the 5 series specifically, and the images of the inside of the lid from Lenovo seem to show that it has the better reinforced hinge design. There's some flex to the plastic screen, and as mentioned earlier, mine did wobble a little while typing. The plastic lid has that phantom blue finish, and the Legion text has a sort of rainbow effect that can be seen depending on the angle of light. There's some flex to the plastic interior, however this wasn't anything I noticed during normal use outside of intentionally pushing hard. The bottom panel just has some air vents towards the back and speakers near the front, and we can see that most of the back has a dust filter with the exception of directly above the fans. Getting inside requires removing 12 Phillips head screws of two different lengths, and like other Legion laptops, it can be a bit awkward to open. I actually broke off two plastic clips in my attempt. I found it easier to open by prying around the back using the tools linked in the description. Just be careful pulling it off, as I've had cracks near the air vents before. Once inside, there are metal plates over the M.2 slots. These are removed by taking out three smaller Phillips head screws from each. While the memory cover can just be pried off, I was able to use my fingernails. There are thermal pads on both of the storage covers. With the metal coverings removed, we've got the 80 watt hour battery down the front, two M.2 storage slots above on the left and right, Wi-Fi 6 card on the right, and two memory slots in the middle. As was the case with the higher tier Legion 5 Pro, my regular Legion 5 uses the exact same X16 memory. So swapping it to X8 memory should give a speed boost, and I'll show you this when we get into the game tests. The two speakers are found underneath on the left and right sides towards the front. I thought they sounded pretty average for a laptop, not great. There's minimal bass and they're a bit tinny at higher volume, and the Latencymon results were looking alright. My Legion 5 has a 4-cell 80 watt hour battery, but there's also a smaller 60 watt hour version too, so expect lower runtime with that. I've tested it with hybrid mode, aka Optimus, both on and off, demonstrating that with it off, the Nvidia GPU burns through more power, resulting in less runtime. It's doing quite well when compared to other laptops, lasting for more than 9.5 hours in the YouTube playback test. Though it's not quite matching last year's Legion 5, granted that one also has lower specs too. You can also run the Legion 5 with a smaller 230-watt power brick. I would think that should be enough to run the 5800H and 3060 as it's enough for other laptops, but I don't have that brick to test. Unlike the higher tier Legion 5 Pro, there's no built-in FN plus R shortcut to swap the screen to 60Hz, so I haven't bothered testing battery life with that, as there's no easy built-in shortcut, but presumably if you did swap to 60Hz, that would boost the battery life even further. What's weird to me is that the BIOS changelog for the Legion 5 since version 23 actually says that they removed the FN plus R shortcut. No idea why, but it sounds like it used to be there. Let's check out thermals next. The Lenovo Vantage software lets us change between different performance modes, which from lowest to highest are quiet, balance, and performance. Balance mode also has an additional option for automatically adjusting the performance based on the workload. So I've tested this too. The power button is above the keyboard, and its light color changes to show the current performance mode in use, which can be changed at any time with the function plus Q shortcut. The idle results down the bottom are quite cool, though as you'll hear later, the fans were still going. I've run stress tests with both the CPU and GPU loaded up to represent a worst case, as well as playing an actual game. Overall, the results are looking quite good. Worst case, the CPU appears to have hit thermal throttling at 95 degrees Celsius in the stress test with the highest performance mode, but we could greatly reduce this by using a cooling pad. The one I test with is linked below in the description. Otherwise, we're sitting in the mid 80s with no throttling on the GPU. These are the clock speeds from the same tests. The CPU clock speed hardly changes outside of quiet mode, but we can see the GPU speed gets a nice boost in performance mode, so presumably it's the extra GPU power that's responsible for increasing the CPU temperature in performance mode, as the cooler has a heat pipe shared between both, and the CPU performance isn't exactly getting better. We can see this when looking at the power levels being hit. The RTX 3060 is running at about 80 watts in quiet and balance modes, at least with this consistent stress test. It differs a bit when running an actual game, possibly due to dynamic boost. This is a full-powered 3060, running up to 115 watts when the CPU is also under load, but it can boost to 130 watts if the processor isn't loaded up. There's no difference in these specific workloads in the Balance Plus automatic tune setting, and I think this is because Lenovo says that it's only supported in 16 different games. That said, when I did thermal testing on the Legion 7 in these same workloads, I did see more of a difference there. Here's how an actual game performs with the different modes in use. Performance mode does the best, and I wasn't seeing any difference with balance mode and the automatic tune option. Here's how the different modes perform in Cinebench R23, a CPU-only workload with the GPU now idle. The single-core performance in quiet mode was super low. Balance was much more reasonable, then of course performance mode was best. It's doing alright compared to others, a little behind the higher tier 5 Pro with same Ryzen 7 5800H, and 15% better than the last-gen Legion 5 with Ryzen 7 4800H when it comes to single-core gains, while multi-core is about 14% higher than last year's model. It's still doing quite well when running on battery power. When unplugged, the highest performance mode you can use is Balance. The single-core score is mostly unaffected, while last year's 4800H model was now just slightly ahead in multi-core performance. But it's still ahead of the Intel 11th gen models in multi-core, though not single-core. It's quite cool when just sitting there idle. 30 degrees Celsius is pretty common, but the Legion 5 was generally below this. With the stress test running, it's barely warm on the keyboard, worst case in the low 40s. Balance mode isn't much different, but the fans increase to offset the higher performance. It's a similar deal in the highest performance mode. There appears to be a warmer spot near the arrow keys, but even touching it directly doesn't feel hot. Let's listen to the fan noise. The fans were still audible when idling in quiet mode. Not loud or anything, but this probably explains the cooler keyboard and internal temps. Fan noise gets louder in the higher modes as you'd expect. Unfortunately, there's no fan control, so these examples should represent the loudest it should get when fully maxed out under heavy load. Now let's find out how well this configuration of Legion 5 performs in games and compares against other laptops. All of the game testing has been done in performance mode with hybrid mode disabled for the best results, as this gives better FPS. I've also tested these games with the stock memory and with my own memory upgrade to X8 sticks. On paper, both memory kits have 2 8-gig sticks, so 16 gigs in dual channel. They're both DDR4 3200 CL22 single rank, but the stock kit has lower timings and X16 banks. You can find the memory kit that I've tested linked down in the description below. Cyberpunk 2077 was tested in Little China with the StreetKid LifePath on all laptops, and I've got the Legion 5 with stock RAM highlighted in red and the upgraded RAM highlighted in green. The memory change is giving a larger boost to 1% lows than average FPS in this test, but even with the stock RAM, this is still the fastest RTX 3060 I've tested so far. The MSI GS76 with lower GPU power limit is about 10 FPS behind, and similar deal for the even lower wattage 3060 in the Zephyrus G14, though that is also much smaller too. Red Dead Redemption 2 was tested with the game's benchmark. There's a bit more of a difference this time between the stock and upgraded RAM. The upgraded Legion 5 is just a few FPS behind the i9 and RTX 3070 in the Zephyrus M16 one position ahead, though the M16 is held back by Optimus. And again, even the stock memory Legion 5 is beating the other 3060 laptops that I've tested so far. Impressively, the Dell G5 with last-gen 5600M is close to the 3060s, so I can't wait to try out the newest 6600M Legion 5 in future. Make sure you're subscribed for that one. Control was tested running through the same part of the game on all laptops. There's basically no difference in this GPU-heavy game with the upgraded memory, and we're just a couple of FPS behind the higher-specced HP Omen 15 with RTX 3070, presumably due to the Omen's lower GPU power limit and lack of disabling Optimus. The Legion 5 is still the best 3060 result I've got, easily ahead of the lower wattage MSI GS76 and ASUS G14 below, and we're reaching more than 60% higher average FPS compared to the last gen Legion 5 with GTX 1660 Ti. Unfortunately, I never had the 2060 model to compare with, but I will compare the 2060 and 3060 in an upcoming video, so stay tuned. I've tested 10 games in total at all setting levels with both the stock memory and the upgraded memory in this video over here if you want to get a better understanding of what sort of a performance difference this makes. Basically, it depends on the game, and you can certainly get performance improvements with the better memory. But for the most part, I found the differences were bigger at lower setting levels. And fact is, with RTX 3060 graphics, you're probably going to be using higher settings. So based on this, I don't think the RAM upgrade is absolutely necessary. It's mostly just a nice bonus, but it does depend on the specific game and settings. Here are the results from 3D Mark for those that find them useful. Now for some creator tests. Adobe Premiere was tested with the Puget Systems benchmark. The Legion 5 was about 11% higher than last year's 4800H plus 1660 Ti Legion 5, so less of a difference going from Ryzen 4000 to 5000, at least compared to the improvement seen with Intel's 11th gen, which is dominating the top of the graph. Adobe Photoshop generally depends on CPU performance, and again mostly Intel 11th gen near the top of the graph, but a few Ryzen options there too. The Legion 5 is doing better than than the Alienware M15 R5 just below it, despite that having higher tier CPU and GPU. DaVinci Resolve is more GPU heavy, though the Legion 5 is slightly beaten by the lower wattage 3060 in the GS76 just above it. So perhaps Intel 11th gen is giving it an edge there compared to Ryzen. I've also tested SpecView Perf, which tests out various professional 3D workloads. The 1TB NVMe M.2 SSD is doing well for both reads and writes. And there's always that second slot if you want to install another drive. The BIOS has quite a few options compared to some other laptops. Granted, many of them are also options that can be configured through software, such as flip to boot. You can enable GPU overclocking through here and control it, but for some reason there's no option to enable it or control it through the Vantage software, which was the case with last year's Legion 5. It also has TPM 2.0. Once GPU overclocking is enabled in the BIOS, the Vantage software reflects this and shows you it's on. But yeah, I couldn't see a way of adjusting it here. I booted an Ubuntu 21 Live CD to test Linux support. Out of the box, the touchpad, keyboard, speakers, Ethernet, and camera worked, but Wi-Fi wasn't recognized. The best thing is that the keyboard lighting effects and performance modes are baked into firmware, so you can still change them with the keyboard shortcuts without software. Let's discuss pricing and availability next. Both of these will of course change over time, so refer to updates with those links in the description, as Lenovo in particular do often run sales. At the time of recording, the Legion 5 starts at $1,100, but that's with the Ryzen 5 5600H processor and RTX 3050 graphics. Now, the 5600H is perfectly fine for gaming in my personal opinion, but the 4GB VRAM limit of the RTX 3050 or 3050 Ti could be a bit limiting, as I've shown in this video over here. The Radeon 6800M version is $1,300 in the US, and that's meant to be an RTX 3060 competitor according to AMD. It looks cheaper than the 3060 model, but if we look closer, it has half the RAM and no SSD by default. So prices will change as you customize it to your needs, which again you can do with the link down in the description. It's also worth noting that these specific options are listed with the smaller 60 watt hour batteries. Overall, there's not a whole lot of changes compared to last year's Legion 5, which isn't necessarily a bad thing given I did award that the best Ryzen gaming laptop for the money for 2020. Is it still the best? Well, no. At least not strictly speaking in terms of things like best performance and most features. I mean, Lenovo even have their higher tier Legion 7 now, for instance. 2021 has introduced a lot of new Ryzen gaming laptops, far more than we ever had last year. I've still got a few models to test out before I make my updated best laptops of 2021 video, so make sure you're subscribed for that. This year's Legion 5 is of course refreshed with newer CPU and GPU options, and the addition of G-Sync and higher refresh rate screen is welcome, though it would have been better for it to come with faster X8 memory by default. But I get it, supply issues during a pandemic and all that. It's the same reason that Legion laptops have been so hard to get lately. Some of them are listed as being 4+ months away. Apart from that slower memory, which can be upgraded, granted at additional cost, there aren't too many other negatives to complain about with this year's Legion 5. I just hope we see some sort of update for the screen overdrive option, as right now the response time is actually slower compared to last year's Legion 5 with 144Hz screen. Battery life was otherwise great, but I'm not sure why they decided to remove the function plus R shortcut to automatically swap the screen to 60Hz, as that would have been an easy way to boost battery life even further. So, all things considered, this year's Legion 5 is a gaming laptop that I can recommend. It just comes down to pricing and availability, which I suppose is the case with most things at the moment. I hope to compare the 5 against the higher tier 5 Pro in a future video, but basically the key differences seem to be some changes to the exterior, and that the 5 Pro has the 16-inch 16x10 screen with a higher resolution. If you're new to the channel, then get subscribed for that upcoming comparison, as well as future gaming laptop reviews like this one. Come and join me in Discord and get behind the scenes videos by supporting the channel in Patreon, and come and check out some of my other videos over here next, including the one where I tested the Legion 5 in 10 different games at all setting levels with both stock and upgraded memory. I'll see you over in one of those next.